When talking about the limits of Minecraft, the Farlands are typically among the first things to be brought up. This makes sense, I mean, just look at them. But what are the Farlands? Why do they generate? How far can you really go? Because if you think about it, the Farlands aren't stopping you from going anywhere. It's just a cavernous mess of blocks. And wait a minute, how come when I teleport to where the Farlands should be, they're nowhere to be seen? Well, I'm about to answer all of these questions and some, but what better way to start off than from the beginning? The first version of Minecraft is pretty recognizable, not because everyone has played it, but just because it's so different from what we have today. You would right-click to break blocks, left-click to place blocks. No, I did not read that backwards, and that's about it. The world's limit is pretty uninteresting in this version. You kind of just fall off the world when you go too far out, and you never really stop falling either. That's basically all there is. When it comes to the survival test versions of the game, you're essentially limited to the area inside the invisible wall that generates around the island. You can see beyond it, but it's just water. I was going to modify my position by saving the world and using a program, but since the world wouldn't save, I'm just gonna move on. However, Minecraft InDev is a different story altogether. Unlike the survival test, there actually isn't anything stopping you from going out as far as you want. As soon as you reach around 2300 blocks on the x-axis, the blocks beneath you will simply no longer render, but they are still there. And just 260 blocks further, the skybox and clouds also stop rendering, leading way to nothing but invisible, flat terrain. But what happens if you go further? Much further. I tried to teleport to a few thousand blocks before the 32-bit integer limit, which if you didn't know, is 2 to the 31 minus 1, and was met with... Well, nothing stopping me from trying again, so I came up with a theory. My thought was that because I was so far out, I fell through the terrain straight into lava. This might not make any sense now, but if you keep watching, it will. So I changed my position to be 1,000 blocks above the ground, because then I knew I wouldn't immediately die. Okay, fine, if I can't go out 2 billion blocks, I guess I'll just be stubborn and go out 4 million instead. Okay, this is better. Not really, I lied. So I was informed that I actually shouldn't be using the x-axis to teleport super far out, so I'll be using the z-axis for the rest of InDev. Anyway, teleporting to 8 million blocks out shows that the hitboxes of blocks have become incredibly warped for some reason. This would sort of carry forward into newer versions of the game, but never this severely. After teleporting past 2 of the 23 blocks, the terrain is no longer solid due to some glitch, and you just fall straight through the world. The closer you get to the 32-bit integer limit, the worse the hitbox gets. In this version of the game, you can actually teleport all the way out to 2 to the 128 blocks. Well, sort of, but I'll let you look into that yourself. Keep in mind that you won't really notice much new after the 32-bit integer limit, though. And now, finally, let's move on to InfDev. InfDev, or Infinite Development, was the first version of Minecraft where the world didn't just abruptly end. In every older version, there was a very obvious cutoff point where the normal world ends, but in this version, that just wasn't there. Assuming you're an average human with an average attention span, there's no way you would reach any sort of game-breaking boundary unless you were actively seeking it. Because of this, Notch, the creator of Minecraft, decided to call the worlds infinite. Of course, it's impossible to make it actually infinite, but again, it's fine. The first even noticeable boundary is where the skybox ends, which only takes a few minutes to reach, but nothing fundamentally breaks here. You would have to travel much further out in order to see any catastrophic failures. Now, because this version of the game is so broken, I was never able to reach these limits on my own. Worlds won't save, hacks won't work, and traveling there on foot is just straight up out of the picture. But the first limit that's noticeable is actually visible in a Minecraft snapshot from 2014. If you load up snapshot 14W30B and teleport to the world border, nothing's wrong, right? Well, how about a little bit of this? Now we're talking. This is the same bug that existed in InfDev, but I couldn't figure out how to teleport that far. The blocks are detaching on chunk borders, and my movement is really stuttery. And the next limit is pretty annoying. I'm sorry, I had to put this in the video. This limit was manually added in by Notch, unlike others, and it exists precisely at 32 million blocks. As soon as you cross this border, you'll fall right through the world. This limit existed to prevent players from reaching the Farlands because those generated at 2 to the 25 blocks away. So, let's go there. Well, as I mentioned, I couldn't for the life of me teleport to them no matter what I tried, so I'm gonna show some footage from a channel who has a lot of video from these limits. To begin, Farlands Investigator, who I will now refer to as just Far, teleports to the edge of the Stone Farlands, or Stonelands, and you can see what they look like here. You can also see the presence of the chunk detaching glitch. While terrain past 32 million isn't solid, you can still swim in water, making that the only real way to stay at ground level. Next, Far teleports to the corner Stonelands, and you can see similar behavior from before. The only problem with this is that because of the chunk glitch, the Stonelands are really hard to observe, which is where the next significant version of InfDev comes into play. As noted by Far, this version has a world border at 32 million blocks, but Far managed to push it out to the 32-bit limit and see the Stonelands without any intruding bugs. This is sort of a breath of fresh air from the epileptic scene from before. These blocks are just normal stone blocks and still generate in the same place as before. But what's interesting is that when teleporting to the corner Stonelands, the walls are completely flat compared to the bumpy mess from before. Subsequent versions of InfDev would add ores and other insignificant elements to the Stonelands, but that pales in comparison to the version released on the 27th of March 2010. It's time to step things up a notch. All of the so-called Farlands that we've seen up to this point have just been complete rip-offs compared to what we saw in the beta versions of Minecraft. Now, I'm sure you've all seen the beta Farlands at least a few times before, but these Farlands just look a little bit off. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. On March 27th, 2010, Notch pushed out the next version of Minecraft InfDev, and this was a big one. It completely overhauled the world generation system again and made it more similar to what would be seen in Alpha and Beta. But more notably, for this video, the Farlands were moved to 12.5 million blocks away from spawn. At the time of release, the world's limit was still 32 million blocks because it was not known that the Farlands had moved. Notch still believed they generated at 33.5 million. Here's a quick math lesson as to why the Farlands generated at 12.5 million blocks. To make it extremely simplified so you don't click off of the video, Minecraft generates its terrain with something called Perlin Noise. It's hard for me to describe exactly what it means, but basically it generates random numbers that are actually less random to make it seem more natural. Minecraft uses a value of Perlin Noise of 171.103 units per block. This creates Minecraft's noise map and generates the world. But how does this generate the Farlands at the seemingly arbitrary distance of 12,550,824 blocks? Well, if you take that value and multiply it by 171.103, you get the 32-bit integer limit. Because the Perlin Noise value is increasing by 171.103 for every block that you travel, it fails when that value hits the 32-bit limit. Thus, the Farlands generate. And this is what they look like. They're just, well, different from what we'd see later, and I don't really know why. And here's the corner Farlands. That's just about all that there is for this version of the game. For the next month or so, no major activity occurred related to the limitations of the game. But we did see at least a somewhat significant update arrive to the players on the 20th of April 2010. The world generator was changed up a bit to make the terrain smoother and just a bit different. At this point in the game, Notch was still figuring out exactly where he wanted to take the game, so sporadic changes like this were nothing unheard of. What's important here are the changes that were made to the Farlands. The appearance of the Farlands was altered in this update to look like how it would for the next year or so. Along with the world changes, the infamous stuttering bug was also introduced in this update. If you haven't seen the stuttering bug before, here's a more detailed showcase. Every time you double your distance from the center of the world, a little bit of numerical precision is lost. This isn't really noticeable for tens of thousands of blocks, but when it does become noticeable, it's pretty annoying. This version has limits that are essentially identical to Beta 1.7, so we're gonna skip straight over Alpha and head up to Beta. But before we do, let's wrap up the InDev and InfDev section with some honorable mentions. In old InDev versions, rain would appear extremely stretched when you traveled extremely high up. I keep saying extreme, but this can only be seen at extreme heights though, so it was never likely to be noticed by people who didn't hack or mod their game. Up until early InfDev, particles would appear oddly stretched at high distances. In just one InfDev version, some plants would appear two-dimensional at high distances too. Also, for a few months in InfDev, terrain would generate very oddly at high distances. And for all of Alpha, and most of Beta, redstone would look weird at high distances too. Okay, that was a lot, so here's about 15 seconds of black screen to calm you down. Just kidding. Welcome to beta. Hope you have a good time here. Well, it's likely that you will because you're just as much of a nerd as I am to be this far into the video. But keep in mind that we're not even halfway through it yet, so pause the video and go refill your drink. You're probably gonna want to. Alright, let's start with the books. For the rest of the beta section, I'm gonna be using a mod to remove the stuttering glitch to make the viewing experience better. Okay, so teleporting to the Farlands shows us what the Farlands looked like. From the previously mentioned infdev version to now, no real changes had occurred to the Farlands. Since I have access to the single player commands mod in this version, it's just easier to observe now. But the Farlands are not the first glitch to occur when teleporting far away from spawn. In fact, there's an even more bizarre glitch that occurs earlier. When teleporting to powers of 2 that are 2 to the 19 or above, you will actually see your spawn chunks out there. The weirdest part about it is that placing blocks in this fake spawn chunk will actually modify your real spawn chunks. Now, if I teleport to another fake spawn chunk, this time in the Farlands, you can see the spawn chunks here, of course. But what's even weirder is that if you teleport back to your actual spawn chunks now, the terrain that was surrounding the fake spawn chunks that you teleported to actually comes back with you, but if you relog, they disappear. This rabbit hole goes pretty deep, and I highly recommend watching Ant Venom's video on the matter. Next, teleporting to 2 to the 24 blocks out and placing rails, ladders, and redstone, we see that all of these blocks experience the familiar stretching. Additionally, water, lava, redstone repeaters, and paintings glitch out too. But in these Farlands lies a deeper secret. According to Ant Venom, another set of Farlands starts at double the distance of the original. But he also noted,
"Unfortunately though, no visual difference can be seen. But I'd guess if the world generated over 8,000 blocks high, you would see a very sudden difference between the two at that kind of height."
So, it's a bust for now. The next limit lies directly at 32 million blocks. No fancy math stuff here, just straight 32 million. When surpassing this point, blocks stop being solid. There was an error in this video that I corrected with some on-screen text earlier, but I said that in infdev, the solid block limit was 32 million blocks and that it was coded in. But back in those versions, it was actually a bug that started at 2 to the 24 blocks away. But in this version, it's a manually added limit at 32 million blocks even. Chunks will still generate, but trees and entities no longer exist after this point without fixing the non-solid terrain. And the next limit exists just slightly over 1 billion blocks away, wherein the Farlands lose essentially all of their detail. These have been dubbed the Fartherlands, and exist about 80 times further away than the normal Farlands. They look pretty bare, but they are what the majority of the Farlands in your world will ever look like, so I guess they could be considered significant. Now for a long time, the 32-bit limit was considered to be the furthest distance that you could possibly travel in-game. If you teleport straight there, your game is just gonna crash. But it was pointed out by a YouTube user named Sulfurus that you can actually teleport all the way to 2 to the 35 blocks if you just skip past the 32-bit limit. The performance out here is really inconsistent, so the gameplay is gonna be laggy on and off. The next limit is really weird, but I'll do my best to explain it. Between these two distances, the clouds, at least on fancy clouds, will completely disappear. On fast clouds, they have been broken since the 32-bit limit, and they either appear stretched or like whatever the heck you can quantify this as. But back to fancy graphics, the way that the clouds disappear depends on where the clouds are and where you are. When you're between the two previously mentioned distances, the clouds will vanish when a certain part of the clouds pass by you. I couldn't personally reproduce this one because the game would just freeze when I approached the limit, but here's some footage from Ant Venom of it in action. And now, for the final limit of Minecraft Java Edition Beta 1.7. Advancing near 2 to the 35 blocks will cause your game to completely lock up and freeze until you kill the process. This is the hard limit for teleporting because it's when chunks begin overwriting each other. No matter how long you leave it, it will just stay frozen. Or so we thought. Referencing yet another Ant Venom video, he figured out that using an external program known as Cheat Engine, it's actually possible to teleport out to infinity in-game. Now the caveat is that you can't unpause the game by exiting the chat. If you do that, the game is, long story short, going to die. But using this program, you can basically teleport anywhere on demand. To learn more, watch Ant Venom's video on the matter. But there are two more things we need to look at in Beta 1.7. The Secret Minecraft Dimension and Optifine. Let's start with the Secret Dimension. Notch used to talk about how he was working on a brand new sky dimension behind the rest of the game. He used to tweet about it sometimes, going even as far as to say that it was confirmed. He would only half follow through on this promise, as we would receive the end dimension 6 months later. He also tweeted some pictures of the dimension, and here they are. And As it turns out, this dimension has Farlands.
It probably has farther lands too, but if you want to know more, visit the Farlands Chronicles page in the references document below.
And now for Optifine.
Optifine is widely known for giving a wide variety of video setting customization to the user and significantly improving the performance of the game. Well, believe it or not, it's existed for over 11 years. By visiting the historical Optifine versions page, it's possible to download a version of the mod for beta 1.7. Something that went unknown about it for a while was a severe visual bug that affected the game more and more the further you went out. Yet again, I'll redirect you to Ant Venom's video on the matter if you want to know as much as possible about it, but what's important is that for every exponent of 2 that you travel away from the spawn point, the entire world starts to look more and more buggy. It can get to the point where if you teleport to 2 billion blocks, it will look like this mess. But that is finally it. We have finally reached the end of the beta 1.7 section. Now, let's move on to beta 1.8. From here on out, everything got a lot simpler. To get it out of the way, the Farlands were completely patched out of the game, and the stuttering bug is also no longer a thing. The world functions quite normally now, all the way out until 30 million blocks. At this point, blocks are no longer solid. It seems that Notch wanted the world to end completely at 30 million, but he couldn't think of a suitable world boundary. That seems pretty dumb, and that's because it is. The distance effects here aren't as interesting, but if you think that we're done with the Farlands, you'd be dead wrong. Just because Notch removed them doesn't mean that we can't bring them back, but we'll save that for later. For now, paintings can't seem to get placed in the right location, unless you're lucky. Along with that, the hitboxes of Cake and Cacti are either 2 blocks long or completely two-dimensional. It can also be even 2x2 at the corner of the world. Also, this isn't a distance effect or anything, but for some reason, there's 2 cake items in the creative inventory. I don't know why Mojang went with the 2D one rather than the 3D one, but you know what? They both place the same cake, so I'm not worried about it. But for beta 1.8, that's actually just about it for the limits within the world boundary. But you can go further. Of course. If you're in creative mode and you try to fly about 32 blocks past the non-solid terrain's beginning, you'll just get stuck. There's actually no way to get unstuck from this state without relogging or using a program to move you out. I find that the relogging method is inconsistent because sometimes a bug causes you to go back to 30 million or so. Typically, you'll have to use a program to get back out. Going about 100 blocks beyond this causes you to also be stuck, but you can see right where the world ends. I couldn't get it on recording, but sometimes if you go about 100 blocks away, you can also get this really stuttery gameplay bug, but I couldn't reproduce it. This isn't the limit, though. For some reason, you can teleport straight to the 32-bit limit without crashing in this version, but the exact same cloud limitations exist too. They break at the same distances as beta 1.7, and you still can't go past 2 to the 35. And that's surprisingly all that there is for beta 1.8, so let's cover the releases now. Let's talk about particles for a minute. I won't touch on it for too long as it isn't really the most interesting glitch, but there were many instances of particles showing up in the wrong location. The further out you go, the worse the precision of the particles get. So I'll quickly run through all of the instances. If you want to see what versions these bugs affected, check out the historical distance effects page in the Minecraft wiki below, where I got a lot of the information for this video from. Okay, buckle up, here we go. Particles that appear when adding an Eye of Ender to an end portal, lava embers, underwater particles, water and lava drops, torch smoke, fire smoke, and furnace flame particles are all broken at far distances. Rain is also affected and disappears completely after 2 to the 24. Void particles, rain particles, lava smoke when it's rained on, redstone ore particles, white TNT particles, and black TNT smoke, spawner and minecart spawner particles, nether portal particles, and mycelium particles. End portal particles, brewing stand particles, landing particles, fishing particles, barriers when placed in creative mode, armor stand breaking particles, end gateway particles, heart damage particles, and sweep particles, squid ink, conduit particles, bone meal particles, redstone repeater particles, dripping leaf particles, campfire embers, smoke particles when soul campfires are rained on, ambient nether particles, and redstone wire particles. Okay, those are all the affected particles. They're all fixed now, but they all plagued many versions of the game. In fact, for nearly 6 years, the entire slash particle command suffered from the same problem. Okay, yeah, particles have had a rough history, but we can be done with them now. In Minecraft Beta, we established that the furthest possible distance for travel was 2 to the 35 without Cheat Engine, but surely that's not the limit, right? I mean, if your processor, operating system, and Java are all 64-bit, why can't we go further? The signed 64-bit integer limit is 2 to the 63 minus 1. So what has been stopping us from going all the way there? Well, theoretically, we shouldn't have been able to pass 32 million blocks in Beta 1.7 and 30 million in Beta 1.8. But why couldn't we alter the game to allow terrain to generate out to the 64-bit limit? Well, until 2021, the reasoning for that was because it would take so much effort and there wasn't anyone willing to develop the mod. But on April 1st of 2021, AntVenom showed off a brand new mod that allows teleportation to the anticipated 64-bit integer limit. So, let's explore our new Minecraft world. I guess the first natural step would be to teleport to 30 million blocks. Nice, the blocks are still solid. 32 million? Nope, nothing. 32-bit limit? Again, no. This is, again, a situation where I'm gonna link you out to AntVenom's video on the matter if you wanna know as much as possible. But if you wanna stay here, I'll say a few things. The limits of this modified version of the game are much weirder than Beta 1.7. Because everything is 64-bit, you can't teleport to 12.5 million blocks and expect to find the Farland. The spawn chunk glitch is back too, but 64-bit. The stuttering is back, but 64-bit. One thing to keep in mind is that the stuttering is no longer just visual. It's actually now the same stuttering bug from Minecraft Bedrock Edition. Instead of moving normally but just visually glitching, you're now actually physically jittering. Eventually, this will impair your ability to move, all the way up to the point where the stripe lands begin. But if you want to know more about this mod, watch AntVenom's video to find out as much as possible. And the creator of the mod, Pyrift, has been going the extra mile to make loads of older versions of the game 64-bit. It's unlikely that we'll see a 64-bit version of something like 1.16 for a long time, but it is technically in the realm of possibility. If you want to download all of these 64-bit mods, I'll leave a link down in the resources document. Okay, let's move on from 64-bit Minecraft. For the next couple of minutes, I'm just gonna show a bunch of miscellaneous bugs that occurred in many different game versions. Again, if you wanna know more, check out the page below, as this video is getting pretty long. If a bug needs explanation, I'll talk, but it'll mostly just be music. Before 2 to the 23, lily pads render normally. At exactly that point, they render oddly, and after that, they stop rendering. To wrap up the miscellaneous glitches section, here's a couple that I couldn't reproduce or didn't include for some other reason. In a little bit, I'll show a glitch related to end crystals naturally spawning in the wrong position, but there is a reason why I'm not showing it to you now, and you'll figure that out. It was a glitch that when you were far enough out, chunks that should definitely be rendered just weren't. The best way to see this is in the 64-bit mod from before. Teleport 5 quintillion blocks away, and you can see it really easily. For some reason, I couldn't get this one to work, but pressure plates sometimes incorrectly detect when players are on and off of them. Their stepping points lose precision and it breaks the whole thing. Tripwires also break and it makes them look like this. Some things break about minecart positioning like the shadow, but this one isn't that bad. And lead knots are placed wrongly too. I've got two more for this section, but information is lacking for both of them. The first one is that terrain features avoid certain stripes of land. I actually don't know what this one looks like because the Minecraft wiki doesn't really have any information on the topic. So what I did was create a replica with WorldEdit as to what I think it would be. Take this with a grain of salt though, as I cannot attest to this actually being what it would look like. And the final one for this section is that mob pathfinding breaks, causing mobs to just awkwardly spin when far away. This only existed for a couple of 1.16 snapshots, so it's again minor. Now I've got two more big patched glitches to show, but since they're major, I think they deserve their own section. The first semi-large distance effect relates to minerals like granite, andesite, and ores. Just like essentially everything ever in Minecraft, these lose precision when far away too. This is what the generation looks like 200 million blocks away from spawn. It's really easy to see this glitch, especially on the surface, because you won't see any variation in the stone type. And this glitch actually causes the game to crash between 2 to the 26 and 2 to the 27 because the veins keep loading chunks over and over. That's the simplified explanation to the crash, but you're welcome to read the bug report too. Okay, it's time to cover one of the most bizarre entity glitches ever. Entity positions lose precision too. I sort of already showed this one with the TNT position glitch before, but this is on another level. Teleporting 2 billion blocks out in an effective version immediately displays the issue, but the internal server lag is really bad out here in some versions. So since TNT is affected by both of these glitches, I decided to light some and wait for it to explode. Here is how long it took. Yeah, that's pretty slow. Spawning in mobs with spawn eggs won't automatically spawn them in the wrong place, but punching them causes their pathfinding location to be at one of the precision loss points. Just like with the rest of these precision loss glitches, these points can be sort of thought of as a grid. The grid points are minuscule distances apart in your spawn, but they get further and further apart the farther you go. Alright, let's review some intended limits that I haven't covered yet. From Minecraft 1.3 to 1.6.4, the limit got a little weirder. Remember, before this, you'd get stuck about 32 blocks after the 30 million block. Limit. But now you can fly past 30 million blocks in creative mode, but reaching 32 million blocks causes you to be kicked out of the world for being in an illegal position. From then, you're taken back to your multiplayer server list. I assume that this is the case because the kick screen is only intended for online servers, but regardless, you still fall through the world at 30 million blocks, so it's mostly unchanged. The next change happened in Minecraft 1.7. When reaching 30 million blocks, you run into a solid air wall that prevents you from traveling further. Well, at least Mojang thought until we broke it. The wall is actually only 2 to 31 blocks high, so you can just teleport over it and fly all the way out to 32 million blocks. You'll still get kicked at 32 million blocks, but oddly, if you press F5 when you're on top of the wall, your game will crash. But that's about as interesting as it gets, as from 1.8 onward, we have the normal world border that we're all used to. While you can throw ender pearls through the world border to get through, there does exist a hard limit at 30 million blocks. But even in the unmodified game, you can still go further. Using a boat, you can drive right past the limit, and the location that chunks stop rendering in this case is where you're rendering. Render distance ended when you were actually at the 30 million block limit, and after that it just kind of all breaks down. But we have essentially reached the end of what you were capable of and what was intended. Strap in for just a couple more minutes as we only have one more section to go. Finally, let's discuss the most recent version of the game, 1.19. We'll start with small distance effects and then we'll bring back the Farlands once and for all. Heading way, way up, throwing projectiles above 2 to the 23 causes them to no longer collide with you. This one is very minor, and as such was marked as won't fix by Mojang. At the end of the day though, it's still unintended gameplay, so it is fitting to include here. Also, when super high up, rain and snow stretch out. It gets worse for every exponent of 2, and then it completely stops rendering after the 32-bit limit. When you're far away from spawn, translucency effects on blocks such as ice and slime start to break too. This is visible within vanilla bounds as well, but it's really hard to see. Along with that, dropped item locations lose precision too. Here you can see me mining stone, but none of the items are appearing near me. They're appearing at some precision loss point that is nowhere near where it should be. This, along with the bug that I'm about to show, are the only ones in this section that I would actually say impair gameplay within vanilla limitations. So what's the other impairing problem? Well, it's that the end dimension completely stops generating after 370,728 blocks, but then it starts again at 524,288 blocks, and it keeps stopping and starting over and over. What's actually happening is that the end is starting and stopping in giant rings throughout the outer islands. As with a lot of these glitches, you should watch Ant Venom's video on this, but I need to move on before I have a stroke editing this. Okay, so sound dies too when you're far away. I hope you're wearing headphones because this one's hard to notice without them. When past 2 to the 30, villages just kind of end themselves. All you'll see is a single structure with maybe some cats, villagers, or maybe an iron golem. Yeah, this is kind of a depressing village. But what's less depressing is snow and other temperature-based blocks lose precision too. Here's some snow after 2 to the 25. It sure does not look how it should. And here it is after 2 to the 27. It just keeps getting worse. Here's a photo with ice too. Ever since the lighting engine changed in 1.14, lighting completely stops working after 2 to the 25 blocks. If you're in version 1.16 or earlier, you can teleport there and see exactly where it stops working. But in 1.17 or above, the game crashes right at the limit, but you can still teleport past it just fine. There's two distance effects left to cover before we bring back the Farlands, so let's do it. Past 2 to the 30, it's possible to get stuck in a block by just walking into it or jumping into it. This one is pretty annoying, but if Mojang fixes this small assortment of issues, then there'd basically be no reason for them not to extend the world's limit all the way out to 2 billion blocks. But there's one more issue. This one will never be noticed by anyone who isn't actively looking for it, but by using mods, it's possible to teleport super high up. Because chunks aren't generating past 320 blocks up, you can basically teleport to infinity. But I won't get ahead of myself. To start, lighting stops working after Y level 2048. Just like how it stops after 2 to the 25 horizontally, it breaks vertically, but that's nothing compared to what comes after this. But I do need to provide a quick disclaimer before we keep going. First of all, I did put an epilepsy warning at the beginning of the video that applied to the entire video. Well, I really need to reiterate it now because what you're about to see is more intense than anything else in this video. The footage for the following glitches is going to come from another video I found that goes way into depth about these limits. I can't really figure out how to pronounce their channel name, but that's okay because any other YouTube channel on this platform is only good for stealing content and using it to have a monetary gain in real life. I joke, of course, I make no money off of this. Also, the following glitches shown apply to 1.17.1. I can't confirm that they still apply to 1.19 because, let's be honest, do I look like I know how to code? It's still fun to look at, though. The first notable one is that below negative 20 million blocks, you don't take any damage in the void. While I couldn't reproduce this one, I believe that it's possible because it was shown in the video. Before we move on to the insane limits, let's quickly go over where you stop being able to move. At least in 1.11, and probably later, you can't move around with the spacebar or the shift key after 2 to the 52 blocks up and down, and after 2 to the 55 blocks, you lose the ability to fall. So that's that, but what are these crazy flashing limits that I've been talking about? Well, let's get into that. Immediately teleporting to the negative 64-bit integer limit and entering F5 mode, colors on the screen start flashing like crazy. In first person, the sky is a weird blue now. Your F5 perspective is also broken now. You're not above yourself. You then teleported to a 50-digit number on the positive y-axis, and everything breaks again. It's even crazier at a 100-digit number because now there's a flat line instead of a faded line. That's all I'm going to show for this glitch because I highly recommend watching Spuds. The final possible limit, this time back to Ant Venom's video, is conveniently the highest possible number that Java can understand. That is 2 to the 1024, but I'm not even going to show it on screen as there isn't probably enough space to fit the number. That just goes to show how high it is. Alrighty then, it's time for the segment that you've probably been waiting for, the return of the Farlands. Bringing them back in modern versions is actually pretty easy. Grab the Forge Farlands mod from GitHub or from Reddit, boot up the game, and teleport there. But the Farlands had remained mostly unchanged since beta, with the only notable change being that they were doubled in height when the build limits changed. Oh, and since I almost forgot, here's the end crystal glitch that I was going to show. The reason I saved it until now is because they don't naturally spawn past the main island, so you have to use the Farlands mod. Okay, back to the exciting stuff. Let's look at the Farlands and a certain version of the game that got everybody excited. A. The snapshot that debuted an early prototype of the brand new Caves and Cliffs world generation. While this wasn't even close to what would actually be seen in 1.17, it was a rough beginning for the developers. But what's most important here is that the Farlands were completely overhauled. Using a different Farlands mod, you can see what they look like. Yeah, they're pretty crazy, and the corner Farlands are even crazier. But this isn't all we can do. Using data packs, it's possible to make vanilla Minecraft world as high as 4,064 blocks. Applying this data pack allows you to have the world generate as high and low as 2032 blocks. Unfortunately, it only generated up and down to about 350 blocks for me, and I don't really know why, but the Farlands can technically generate that high and low, assuming your data packs work correctly. But for whatever reason, there aren't any farther lands in this version. Of course, Mojang would turn around on the Caves and Cliffs update for a while, delaying the changes to 1.18. But notably, 1.18.2 and 1.19 have different Farlands. It's unknown if this is a bug with the mod or a quirk in the game, but they now appear appear as just a giant weird wall with caves inside. They also only generate up to about 256 blocks, at which point they round off. This did not apply to the initial 1.18 release and the other dimensions. By the way, if you were curious, this is what the Farlands look like in the Nether and End in 1.18. Yeah, they're just the same as previous versions because the world generation was never changed in those dimensions. Except for the End, which has the ring glitch from before. Oh, wait, we're done? Yeah, I think we're done. Nope. Okay, I promise that this is the real last section of the video, I swear this time. There's one more notable data pack that AntVenom provided in his video. When using the Farlands mod, you can modify some values to allow the sky and void Farlands to generate. Yeah, those places have Farlands. We've just never been able to see them without modifying the game because the world only generates 384 blocks vertically. The previous way to see the void Farlands was by using the cubic chunks mod. You can still do that in 1.12.2 to get the old classic Farlands look. But anyway, there's another way to get the sky Farlands in 1.12.2 and earlier without even modifying the game. By changing some preset numbers and customized world settings, you can spawn into a world and see the sky Farlands right above you. They're pretty much impossible to ignore, and they dig right into your entire world. And for the final time, AntVenom also made a video on the matter that you're welcome to check out. But alright, thanks for sticking around to the bonus section. But what about Bedrock Edition? To start off, the Farlands- Okay, I'm joking, there's no more. I've spent way too long in this video, goodbye.